Well, hey everybody. Happy Thursday. Can't believe that it's Thursday again. Where's the time going? It seems to be flying, even in quarantine, at least for me. Anyway, I'm Julie, and I'm the children's director here at Clearview, for those who don't know. And I just wanted to share some thoughts with you this morning. So, Zach asked us to continue to think about the thought he introduced. The statement, because Jesus is alive, I can, and then fill in the blank. And so we've all been sort of taking turns reflecting on some of those different things that are true because Jesus is alive. I really liked what the pastors have had to say so far this week, like Brandon talking about because Jesus is alive, I can believe, and Pastor Zach talking about because Jesus is alive, I can worship in spirit and in truth. And then Pastor Tom talking about just the surprises that God gives us because he is alive. So I'm going to piggyback on some of those things this morning, as well as some of the things I talked about last week. So my word for because before this statement is because Jesus is alive, I can go. And I've just been thinking a lot about this. That word go probably sounds like a weird word to say when we're all stuck and we can't go anywhere. But let me just clarify. So, the disciples, before they knew that Jesus was alive, after he had been crucified, I just find this ironic. They all went up into a room and they shut themselves in the room and they were afraid to go out because there was an enemy out there and they were afraid and they didn't know what to do because they thought Jesus is dead. Now what? Our enemy's going to get us. There was no hope for them. They didn't know where to go, what to do. They eventually tried to return to their former lives. And as Pastor Tom and Zach have talked about, Jesus came and interrupted that plan. But they were shut up in fear and they didn't know what to do. But Jesus walked into that room of fear where they were stuck. And he said, "Peace to you, as the Father has sent me, I also send you." That's in John 20:21. So Jesus came to them, and the first thing he said is, "Peace to you." And then, because I'm alive and because you can have peace, now I want you to go. So, fast forward a few months, and they were again together, and Jesus had ascended into heaven and told them to wait, and they were again all gathered in a room. But this time, because they knew Jesus was alive and they knew his promises could be trusted, excuse me, they were believing him and they were worshiping, just as our pastors have talked about this week. And they were one, just as Jesus had prayed for them to be. And so they were praying and they were in supplication all together as one. And that is when Jesus came to them and the Holy Spirit visited them and came upon them. And as we know, after that, they were sent and they did go and they went all over the world. They all went to different places and had different experiences, but they all were sent in one form or another. And they could do that because Jesus was alive. And each one of them had sinned and had let Jesus down and had done some really stupid things, like Peter. He did a lot of stupid things, but Jesus restored him. And Thomas doubted him pretty openly and blatantly, but Jesus forgave him and restored him. And then later, Paul was persecuting and murdering Christians who believed in him, and Jesus sent him. So our sin has nothing to do with it. It's the mercy that we receive from God. And when we know that he's alive and when we have that forgiveness in our hearts, he brings that new life and he gives us his spirit and we can go. And so I was just thinking about that, just that idea of being sent. And, being sent, it may not mean that we go physically far. Some of us are called to go physically far all over the earth. But where we go depends on what the Lord has to say to us and the experiences that He gives us. So for some of us right now, being sent, like for me, some days that means just putting down my phone or putting down whatever I'm working on and listening to my kids and hearing them work on their schoolwork or tell me about their day or whatever it is, just being there for them or talking with them through fears that they have. For some of us, it may be, you know, you don't have much to do at home, but you have neighbors who need you, or you have people around you who need hope or things that you can do for them. Or maybe you're working on the front lines in the grocery store and leaving your house every day to expose yourself to this possible virus in a way that others of us don't have to do. Or maybe it's you're on the front lines in the medical field. There's all kinds of ways that we're being sent, but God is sending each one of us, and He does have a plan for us to go. So as I was thinking about that and just thinking through the Bible and the people who went wherever the Lord asked them to go, there's just so many stories. I mean, everywhere you look in the Bible, there's these stories of God using people and how He sent them. But it led me to Hebrews 11 and 12. And Hebrews 11 is the Faith Hall of Fame. I'm not going to read that whole chapter here, but you can go and read that and just be reminded of the different things that the people of God went through, and the way that they obeyed because God had sent them and because they had a hope. They knew that He had come, that He was alive, that He was for them. And so they had a reason to hope, even when some of their situations seemed really hopeless, or even when they were called to a lot of suffering or an uncertain future, they still had that hope and they still went. And then in Hebrews 12, it talks about how we are surrounded by this cloud of witnesses. And I love how Paul uses a lot of athlete imagery, especially running, because I love to run. I used to be a big runner, and I still love to run a little bit, but he talks a lot about running. And I love these verses that just talk about how we can run the race that is set before us because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, and how Jesus ran the race that was set before Him. And He's the author and perfecter of our faith. And because He ran that race and because He is alive, we can now run the race that is set before us. And so the race set before you is different than the race that is set before me. But nevertheless, it's a race that God is asking you to run. And running a race requires endurance, and it requires you to train, and it requires you to think about it, and to sometimes hurt while you're running. It's not always easy. A lot of times it's painful. But it is a race that God is asking us to run, and He talks a lot about just our reward. And I love in 1 Corinthians 9:24 and 25 how He says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever." So our prize, besides, you know, getting to proclaim the name of Jesus and leading people to His kingdom, is to get this crown that will last forever. And so we have such a high hope and such a high calling in this time. And we really can go and tell the world, because we have so much more hope that they don't have. You know, I've been hearing a lot of people on the radio or whatever talk about, you know, what is our hope for the future? What is our hope in this time? And they say some good things, you know, about things that people are doing and coming together and progress that's being made. But a lot of it is just based on, you know, our own survival. And some people are just really hopeless. And you don't hear a lot of just this eternal hope and this idea of rejoicing in we have eternity, and Christ has already defeated the greatest enemy. And there are so many people out there right now who need that hope. So I am really excited to see how we're going to get to go during this time, because the last way that we could go, even though we can't physically go anywhere, like I've said before a few times, we have this incredible tool that has been given to us that we really can go out into the world and proclaim His name if we want to. And if we will be obedient to do that, we can proclaim His love and His name through our presence online or whatever it is, we can lift him high and we can praise him that way. And we can proclaim him and go through this new medium that's been given to us. As I was thinking about this, one person who came to mind is one of my life heroes, who is Corrie Ten Boom. I love Corrie Ten Boom, and she just, her life and her books and just the way that she learned to see God and know God just constantly inspire me and bring me to my knees. If you haven't read The Hiding Place and her follow-up book called Tramp for the Lord, read them. You will forever be changed by her story and just by her huge, huge heart and her bravery. If you haven't read Tramp for the Lord, it's the one that she wrote after she got out of the prison camp about what happened next in her life. And, you know, she was in a concentration camp, lost everything, came out of that just weak, starving, no home, no possessions, no anything, except that her heart was so full of the Word of God that she had been able to read all through that time in the camp. And she just knew that God had told her to go around the world and share his gospel. And she didn't have any other message or agenda except just to share him. And her life and the way she lived and the way she went is just amazing to me. I think it's really fun that God brought her to my mind because I'm actually recording this on Wednesday, April 15th. And as I was researching her a little bit, April 15th was her birthday, and it was also the day that she died. So today, April 15th, is Corrie Ten Boom's 128th birthday. And of course, she's in heaven right now rejoicing with the Lord. But I love that we can remember a little bit of her story and the way that she was so faithful. You know, and when we start thinking that we have it hard or that we're afraid of the future or what's coming, we can just remember her story and the faithfulness that she had and just the love of God and the love of his word that really compelled her through so many circumstances. So I just wanted to end with a couple of quotes by her that just, I've been reading through her book again and it's just been inspiring to me. So she said one thing: if you look at the world, you'll be distressed. If you look within, you'll be depressed. But if you look at Christ, you'll be at rest. And I love that. She really did portray that. Like, she just constantly looked at Christ, and she would travel around the world never knowing where the next meal was coming from, never knowing how God was going to provide or pay for her to be there or go to the next place. But instead of getting depressed or distressed, she just looked at Christ, and she was just at rest, and he always provided exactly what she needed, exactly when she needed it, through many miraculous ways. And she also says, if God sends us on stony paths, he provides strong shoes. So maybe he will call us to go into some stony places and to some travel some hard paths. But if he sends you, he's going to give you what you need to take the journey. And he's going to always provide exactly what you need. And then this quote is one that she's probably most famous for, and I love it. She says, never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. You know, we don't know our future. We don't know what's going to come next with all of this. We can make guesses. A lot of people are predicting things. There's a lot of fear. And maybe some of those things are coming. But you know what? We don't know the future, but we know our God. And we know that he's got us. And we know that because he's got us and because he is alive, we can go. And we have such a message of hope that we can give to other people. Maybe your kids need that hope today. Maybe your neighbor needs that hope. Maybe your spouse or your loved ones need that hope. Or maybe you just need to tell yourself that hope today. But we have a known God who knows our future. And because Jesus is alive, we can go into the world with that hope. And Corrie Ten Boom, you know, she traveled all over the world for decades after she got out of the concentration camp. But the last five years of her life, she actually had several, a series of strokes. And the first stroke rendered her unable to speak. So she could no longer speak and give her messages like she had. And then her second stroke left her paralyzed. And those last 5 years of her life, she was pretty much bedridden. But she never stopped praying. What she would do all day, every day, is just pray for believers around the world and pray for the people who needed to hear the gospel. So even though she was stuck in her bed for 5 years, she never stopped going out and she never stopped spreading the word and the good news of the gospel. So the reason she was able to do that is because she rested in the Lord, her eyes were on him, and she knew his word backwards and forwards, and she was filled with it. So that's where we need to start. But then after that, you know, get your shoes on. We've got places to go, and God wants to send us out into a world that really needs him right now. So I hope that will encourage you today. I hope that you'll listen to where he's sending you and what he might be asking you to do, and that we as a church and as his Clearview body can really continue to reach the world more and more for him and lift his name up and see, just see how his kingdom comes because of our going, because we have the hope that Jesus is alive. So that's my thought for your morning, and I hope you have a wonderful day. Bye.